I believe he is the 14-year-old Brazilian player that's kind of sparked some interest in the Brazilian scene, the Latin American scene, due to his performance in these past tournaments.
Do you think there's any advantage to being the youngest player?
Eu acho que não. Acho que todos os jogadores, eles analisam que todos que vão estar, todos que estão nesse meio têm um nível de habilidade parecido. Então eu não vejo nem vantagem nem desvantagem. Eu acho que vão todos jogar de igual para igual e não vai ter diferença.
How difficult is it to play against an unknown player versus someone that you get to watch post their deck list and play on stream?
A lot of the top players have a variety of decks that they can play, so they can still be unpredictable with their lineups. But yeah, not knowing much about someone or what decks they excel in definitely makes, you know, playing against them a little bit more difficult, I would say. So yeah, it's definitely tougher.
Are you still feeling relaxed?
Sim, eu não. Eu tô bem confiante, eu acho que com o que eu tô levando e com meus resultados até agora, eu tô bem confiante. Não vai ser muito difícil, todos os jogadores são de nível excelente, mas eu tô bem tranquilo, eu tô na mesma. Eu não tô me cotando como classificado, eu não tô com a obrigação de ganhar. Então vou bem relaxado e vou dar o meu melhor para conseguir a vaga.
The Brazilian scene is completely different from the US scene. So what do you think about that?
They would be right in saying that, you know, they typically run slower decks, and it seems that they don't favor Grimpatron Warrior as much as North Americans or Europeans do. They seem to be favoring decks like mid-range Paladin, mid-range Hunter, slower Hunter versions, Control Warrior versus Grimpatron Warrior. So they do seem to favor a different type of play style than the North American players.
Are you familiar with the player VLPS?
É um ótimo jogador, muito bom. Todos os jogadores que estão qualificados são bons, ele também é muito bom. É um player que eu estudei, não cheguei a estudar muito, mas agora sabendo vou até dar mais uma aprimorada, mas é um player muito bom de alto nível e vai ser muito legal jogar com ele na primeira rodada. É isso, eu vou treinar bastante, vou estudar bastante, mas vai ser de bem de igual para igual.
Versus VLPS.
All right, we are back with the Hearthstone World Championship, America's Championship. Once again, I'm TJ, joined by Robert A. Wing once again, and Brian Kibler joining us on the desk. We've had some exciting games today, but these guys are ready to go. There's the handshake, and they're going to take their seats for our fourth match of the day. We've had some pretty great matches today. Brian, what have you thought about the match so far?
I mean, we've had some incredible moments. You know, we saw everything come down in the final match, the final game, yeah, of Trump versus Jab. You know, that really exciting moment with the Spell Slinger off the top to find tracking, to find Fireball. And, you know, we saw some, you know, pretty remarkable near comebacks from players who were down a significant number of games.
Yeah, and that last match too, going to game number five once again. About a lot of them today.
Yeah, I'm super impressed again by Correa. Purple, as I've said, is just one of those amazing high-level players that comes out of North America. But Correa coming into this as someone who had a lot to prove and kind of show off a lot about who he is as a player. He played very well, and I'm super excited to see more of him later.
All right, well, let's take a look at these guys. VLPS versus Molagel. Another Brazilian player. This kid is 14 years old, the youngest player by far competing at the America's Championship. And he hasn't really been that shy. I mean, he's sort of been standing back, but he had a lot of bold words to say.
Yeah, I mean, one thing that VLPS was saying during the interview we just saw was that he thought that, you know, his opponent was going to be very unpredictable.
Yeah.
That they were not likely to bring many of the common decks we've seen other players choosing. And we look at Molagel's lineup, and he's playing none of the really popular classes for the most part. He doesn't have Warrior in his lineup. He doesn't have Warlock in his lineup. And he was saying that he expected the possibility of a mid-range Paladin is exactly what he's playing right now.
Yeah.
Right. These two, prior to actually getting to this point, a few days they've been hanging out now. And, you know, Molagel and VLPS have actually been kind of like hanging in the same areas a lot and kind of talking to each other, you know, as much as they can, obviously. And VLPS, you know, had kind of told me that, you know, Molagel is actually despite being a 14-year-old, he's a reasonably imposing opponent.
Yeah.
VLPS is, there is no universe where VLPS thinks this will be an easy series. In fact, I think quite the opposite. I think he absolutely believes in for quite the fight.
VLPS is a very preparation-focused player, and he was sweating because Mojel was a player that he couldn't do as much preparation as he could have for some of the other opponents. So he said, this is the one that I'm most afraid of.
And this start here from Mojel against VLPS, the Zombie Chow into Minibot is pretty much the most powerful opening that his mid-range Hunter deck can, or mid-range Paladin deck can have against the Hunter. He has multiple minions that can contest the board early, and that's when the Hunter deck needs to be able to get its advantage.
Yes.
To VLPS's advantage now, Mulligel's curve for the rest of the next few turns here, at least from what we can see, assuming he doesn't draw something else, is actually a little bit weak.
That's true.
He'll pretty much be in a situation where he has to hero power, but yeah, as you mentioned, Shielded Minibot, quite possibly one of the strongest two drops, if not the strongest two drop in the game. Super difficult to deal with, especially for a deck like, you know, Hybrid Hunter, which is what BLPS is playing here, that wants to try to establish early board position, kind of get out to that lead. And Mulligel is very much keeping him in check, even with kind of the bland turn three.
Yeah, he had a really slow start. Only being able to use his hero power on turn three is never what you want, but those cards early put him in a really fantastic position. And as this game goes on, you'll see Mojo, the Brazilian players, they tend to put a lot of interesting cards in their Paladin deck, and I'm hoping we're going to see one.
Well, there's one.
There's one, yeah.
Also cards like Tuskar Jouster, the 5-5 that it jousts for a heal effect, and even some other cards, and we'll see as this game goes on what type
this
of things
this is an interesting decision from Mulligel here. He chooses not to attack with his two minions, and that leaves three minions on the board, which opens him up to this exact situation, which is the Unleash the Hounds from VLPS, which is particularly punishing because of the Knife Juggler as well. He's able to just wipe out Mulligel's entire board this turn.
That said, you have to imagine Mulligel realizing he has Consecration in hand, even though it's not a super satisfying turn 5 for him, he does realize that he has a way to at least get rid of the Knife Juggler, get rid of the dogs. Doesn't do anything to deal with, well, it does a little bit of damage, but it doesn't deal with the bear.
If he had chosen to attack just his Zombie Chow into the bear, he would be able to set up a Consecration that completely clears the board.
Yeah.
Right, and actually this VLPS is suddenly...
He's suddenly very far ahead.
Very far ahead, yeah. And we see he's going to be curving out right into that high main, and this is going to spell a lot of problems. I want to touch real quickly on Justicar Trueheart in Mulligel's Paladin deck. This is now something I've seen Trump running this in mid-range Paladin as well. We're starting to see some of the competitive level players think it's not just for Control Warrior. You can also do it in Paladin. It kind of helps with the Zerg strategy for Paladin, which is, you know, Murloc, Knight, comes out, Justicar Trueheart comes out, you just keep flooding the board over and over.
Yeah, Justicar Trueheart, you know, since it's been released in the Grand Tournament, it can be used in any class, obviously, but it's at its best in decks that are looking to play a very long game. The more times you are planning to use your hero power over the course of a game, the more value you're getting out of that ability.
Yeah, and you can see here, VLPS is one of the only players in the North American Qualifier Tournament, and even if you go back to the Last Chance Qualifier, who played a hybrid variation of Hunter. A lot of players went with either pure mid-range or very few also went with, you know, the face of the very aggressive variation. So he really likes that type of deck where you play really aggressive early on with cards like Leper Gnome and Abusive Sergeant and Glaive Zooka, but then you curve out into high main. So your opponent's using these resources to kill off your early creatures, and then you slam down the high main. A lot of times, they just don't have a way to deal with it.
Yeah, I like VLPS's decision there to not trade into the Healbot. He just realized, like, he read the situation, he's like, all right, now's the time. He's gonna be on 7 mana, there's no chance of a lay on hand. I gotta start putting in that damage, I'm not gonna see Tyrion Fordring. Mulligel actually gives out
dear.
The well played.
And that's actually just lethal.
Yeah. Wow. Mulligel gonna concede that. That is a quick game one to VLPS, who wins off the back of, obviously, as you said, the kind of that hybrid Hunter build, identifying when he needed to go ahead and switch it up. It's not time to trade anymore. It's just time to go face. Face is the place.
And that's what it's designed to do. It's designed to sort of end games quickly. He didn't even need to use the high main. And also, you could sell with the nice Piloted Shredder placement from VLPS, putting it in the middle of his creatures
Shredder
to hedge his bets for Direwolf Alpha or Flame Tongue Totem. So a little bit of a lesson to maybe everybody at home watching who likes to play Piloted Shredder in their decks.
I mean, we saw one of the reasons that Paladin decks can often struggle against Hunter in that game. Paladin decks are often designed to sort of flood the board, whether it's with Muster for Battle or just using their hero power multiple times. And Unleash the Hounds is just one of the best cards against them, especially in combination with Knife Juggler, as we saw that game.
Yeah, and our very own Rachel had a chance to sit down with VLPS earlier in the week to talk about growing up and being competitive in things outside of video games.
What did you do in your free time? Like, what else led up to you this?
I've always been a competitive guy. Like, I've always played sports growing up. I played sports in high school. Still played club sports in college. So I've always been a competitive guy. I've also played other games, not at quite this level, but I've always been competitive in the games that I've played as well. I've always been a fan of Blizzard games, World of Warcraft, Dota not being a Blizzard game, but just MMOs and games, MOBAs like that, that are, you know, competitive in nature, I've always been a fan of.
Alrighty, that's the players. Get ready to go into game number two. If you're Mojel in that situation, you have to be pretty intimidated going into the first matchup of your first game, traveling all the way from Brazil to get here. He's had to sit around for the last couple days listening to these players talk and sort of sitting on the back lines going in, and losing that first game's got to be rough.
I mean, it's never a particularly happy position to be in, down a game in a series here.
Yeah.
But I mean, in Conquest, that's just something that happens, you know, a significant percentage of the time. You have to be mentally capable of responding to that sort of challenge and coming back and still playing your best despite being behind.
This will be a big check for Mojo, who, you know, hasn't had necessarily the experience that VLPS has. Obviously, VLPS played in that North America versus China tournament. He ended up helping to secure the win along with other players such as Firebat. And, you know, I had the chance to talk to him over the week, and he said that being in that big tournament was such a rite of passage for him as far as competitive Hearthstone goes, because he got to play with some of the people he looked up to. He got the experience of being in that, you know, I guess, huge tournament setting, and it's obviously made him a better player. He has consistently gotten better month by month, routine high finishes on the ladder, and Molojel is going to kind of have to see if he can go toe-to-toe with that and really show that, you know, that first loss is not sticking with him.
Yeah, Molojel is actually a player that qualified through the Last Chance qualifier in Latin America, and he did it because he just had a couple of small tournament finishes. He had very few points going in. He didn't have any of those top 100 legend finishes. He claims that he doesn't really like to play ladder. He likes to just participate in smaller tournaments like that and really have fun with those. So coming from sort of completely different backgrounds, these players, well, BOPS started as a ladder hero. Mojel started in small tournaments. They come from completely different backgrounds and expertise.
Yeah, Mojel's one of those players who, you know, he kind of comes from, obviously Fireside Gatherings are a big part of the Hearthstone experience where you can get together with friends and you can get together at like local smaller tournaments. And he's definitely one of those players who prefers that setup, as you pointed out, as opposed to the ladder grind, which is one of those things where it can be a huge time investment.
Yeah,
and VLPS was talking a little bit about the inability that he had to predict the cards that his opponents might be playing. And this is one that not many players would expect to see. Mojel just picked up Leroy Jenkins.
Brian, let me correct you. That's golden Leroy
it
Jenkins.
Is. Yes, it
As
is.
Someone
fancy.
Who recently crafted one, I can say it is just thrilling when you get to drop a golden Leroy on someone and end the game.
Yeah, you're right. It's never expected. And judging by this hand, it looks to me like it has a lot of mid-range elements for the Hunter. I mean, we haven't seen the majority of the deck, so there could be things like Leper Gnome. He might be running a Hybrid Hunter of his own, but Leroy is definitely an aggressive card.
Yeah, I mean, we saw, I believe, Houndmaster in his opening hand, but he was mulligan.
That's so true, we did.
So this is a very interesting take on sort of mid-range style of deck, but has that burst kill thanks to Leroy.
Has the reach.
What makes mid-range better? An extra 6 damage with charge. I mean,
what makes every deck better, Rob?
Exactly.
An extra 6 damage with
you
charge.
You can slow down a Hunter and you can say, oh, this is a mid-range, we're going to trade. But at the end of the day, Hunter is all about putting out that burst damage all at once, and Leroy helps you get there. Plus, and this is something I've been doing a lot on ladder lately, turn it, you just Leroy into the Unleash the Hounds, just like the good old days, and you're doing a lot of damage.
We did see Mojel just pick up the Unleash the Hounds this turn. Not really near the ability to actually cast those at this point, but
right.
Here is me deciding exactly how he wants to approach this turn. He does have that freezing trap, which is very, very valuable at potentially stopping that Void Caller from attacking, say, a Piloted Shredder they might play this turn.
Right.
Though, just playing Freezing Trap here feels pretty bad. When you're in the hunter seat, you really need to be putting pressure on your opponent. And only playing, say, Freezing Trap and Hero Power this turn, he could use his coin to also play the bow, but that's also a little awkward.
Yeah, then his curve going into turn 5 is not the greatest because he's probably going to play Powder Shredder anyway. But I suppose he's just going to Hero Power, yeah. So a little bit awkward there, like you said, but I mean, it gets the job done. Freezing that Void Caller back to the hand is a pretty big deal, not having to deal with it.
Void Caller also, it's not written on the card, but Void Caller is also just terrifying to deal with, and sometimes you just want it to go away. So you don't have to worry about the Doomguard, you don't have to worry about the Mal'Ganis or the Jiraxxus, and I think that's what he decided to go ahead and do pretty much for that reason, so you don't have to worry about the threat of it.
The problem for him is that VLPS is playing the Handlock style deck, which does include cards like the Sun Fury Protector we see on the left there that can enable the Void Caller to just get taunt. But it looks like VLPS is not going to wait to try and do that. He just attacks into the Freezing Trap, clearing that out of the way.
Right. Now, obviously 5 mana, VLPS, Doomguard. This is not a card that actually ever, basically ever gets played out of the hand for Handlock because resources are so important. You usually want to get it off the big Void Color swing, but Leok is one of those minions that, if just left on the board, situations can arise where Leok is actually super problematic, and I gotta wonder how long VLPS is gonna let Leok just sit on the board.
He didn't really have any plays last turn, though. Dark Bomb doesn't kill a Leok, and he needed to tap to sort of get deeper into his deck to find more threats. He's not low enough to play that Molten Giant quite yet, but he will be in a few turns, judging by how big of a board Mol'Jel is actually creating.
Right, Mol'Jel elects to coin out the Haunted Creeper, so it looks like he's going to go ahead in the next two or three turns here, be looking to finish off the LPS if possible. He's really starting to put that pressure down. He doesn't save the coin for something like Leroy Unleash. So he's got a good board now. It's very sticky. Can resist a board clear and still have some stuff on the board.
It's actually pretty interesting here. The VLPS plays his Emperor, and with that Leroy, Mol'Jel nearly has lethal damage.
Yeah.
Wow, and the Leok actually buffs it up too.
Yeah, so he currently has 9 damage on board. With Leroy getting buffed, that would be another 7. So he could do 16 damage this turn, put VLPS down to 4. It's very dangerous to do that kind of burst damage that doesn't actually finish your opponent off against the Handlock, especially when Emperor Thorsten is just sitting in play as well.
It's one of those things where usually, in my experience in this matchup, you usually want to try to get the Handlock somewhere around like 16 or 15 to where they can't really play conveniently the Molten Giant in something else until, you know, around turn 10, and then look to finish them all at once with something like a bow, a hero power, some sort of direct damage spell, and then what's on the board, as opposed to letting them just have the taunted Molten Giants.
Yeah, I think a lot of it depends on what threats you have in your deck as the mid-range hunter. If you know that you have high main sitting in the rest of your deck, or if you know that you have big threats that you can follow up on, then yeah, you can hold them. But a lot of times when you're playing a more aggressive hunter, you just have to sort of go for it and hope they don't have it, because once they play a wall, you're not going to get through it anyway. So unless you know that you're going to be able to kill them in the next couple of turns, a lot of times it's just better to just go for it and hope they don't have the tools to be able to build up a huge wall.
Right. You see, Mol'Jel is actually debating whether or not to attack with these minions. Like, where does he want VLPS's health to be sitting at? And he decides 18.
Yeah.
It becomes even more dangerous when your opponent has used Emperor Thorsten, because those health flashpoints and mana combinations that can actually allow them to play a bunch of large minions like Molten Giant with taunt get a lot lower.
And they're harder to calculate, too. They're harder to play into, because you don't know, especially a couple turns after Emperor Thorsten, you don't know which cards he had reduced. At some point, if you get him to like 12 health, he might be able to play double Molten Giant, taunt them up, and play an anti-Killbot in the same turn without having to go below like 10 and get into sort of those danger zones, those red zones.
Right. We see VLPS here is considering now, Mol'Jel not attacking with the minions last turn really kind of is a tell as to what, you know, Mol'Jel is looking to do in the next turn here. So he's got to navigate basically what is the correct way to deal with this board. And it's like Shadowflame Void Caller is the way to go. And he might get a Void Caller, might get a Doomguard. We'll see which one he ends up getting.
Either way, he's coming really strongly back onto the board. So even though Void Caller comes out, that's something that's going to fight for the board. That's something that's going to bring out the Doomguard in future turns, unless it gets silenced, which we do see an Iron Beak Owl in the hand. So
at this point, you have to be, if you're in Mol'Jel's spot, you have to be thinking about the need to punch through big taunts with that Owl. Yes, you really want to stop your opponent from getting any, you know, fancy demons off of the Void Caller, but even just your opponent getting a big minion and taunting it up with something like Sunfire Protector is a really difficult thing for you to get through.
It's very true, especially since did we see an Owl early on? That was an Owl from VLPS on the Mad Scientist,
right?
But I don't think we've seen one. I'm not sure if Mol'Jel runs 2 Iron Beak Owls in this Hunter deck. It's possible. A lot of the more aggressive Hunters do run 2 because they really need to crucially get through walls later on. They don't have the big creatures to do so.
Mol'Jel's kind of in the same spot he was last turn. Now again, he has to figure out how low does he want to put VLPS. He could possibly look at trading that Fairy Dragon that's boosted up to 4 attack into the Void Caller, but again, what's behind door number 1? Is it Mal'Ganis? Is it Jiraxxus? Did he dodge a bullet there by drawing out the Void Caller last turn? And looks like 16. Nope. Oh no, he's going for it now.
Yeah,
it is time to go phase.
I think he realizes that, you know, it's going to be hard for him to win if he keeps holding on. It's just going to give VLPS more time to tap and use these big threats. So he realizes, you know what? I have to go now. I have to hope that he doesn't have it. And, you know, he does have some pieces, VLPS. But can he have enough to stabilize through what we see as being a lot of damage from Mol'Jel's hand?
That Doomguard coming out is going to allow him to deal with even more threats. He's got Sun Fury, he's got Healbot, and this is unfortunately, like, at some point as the Hunter, you have to get. You have to try to win the game, and we saw Mol'Jel pretty much decided last turn that was the turn to go for it, and VLPS just happened to have the answers in hand, and after Mulligel, he does have one silence. But unfortunately, he doesn't really have a convenient way he could possibly look at equipping the bow to deal with the Doomguard. And even then, silencing the Molten Giant, that's still an 8-8.
Knife Juggler Unleash is picked up, though, and that can be a pretty big swing card. It's really tough when you're going up against an 8-health Molten Giant and a 5-health Doomguard that are both taunted. Those juggles aren't really going to make too much of a dent in those, but, I mean, it's a start.
It's a shame there's not a world where he could wait until turn 10 to do the,
Juggler, Unleash, Leroy.
Leroy. Just really pull out all your guns. Just come out blazing.
Yeah. Well, it'll be Juggler, Leroy, Unleash. We got to get the order right.
Right. This is why
it
we're casting,
matters.
TJ. This is why we're casting.
Don't get too ahead of ourselves. He is going to go for the combo. And, I mean, these juggles are actually hitting the important targets.
Yeah.
Okay, 3 out of 4 hit the targets that he needs
you
to get
You put too
through.
Much pressure on the Knife Juggler, TJ. He was doing his job, and then you had to come in.
I'm sorry, Knife Juggler.
And the rope ticks down, but this is actually a little bit awkward, too, because the Mad Scientist picked up a trap, and very likely that's Freezing Trap, and there is the anti-heal button on the board.
Yeah.
As well as the Sunfire Protector, both of these are very dangerous minions to allow your opponent to get back to their hand.
Let's not say for sure. I mean, he does have Leroy. There's a chance it could be... Nope.
There it is.
Okay, never mind. I'm sorry. I don't know what I'm talking about.
There was a possibility.
Sure, but very likely.
Yeah.
I wanted to believe.
Yeah, we did see a Snake Trap earlier in one of the matches. I believe it was Nias who was running that. So a little bit of trap variety throughout the Hunter decks so far.
It's still important to note now that VLPS cannot combo Hellfire, even as discount, and NT Killbot, so...
That's true. It's interesting to me, actually, that the VLPS just sort of automatically attacked the Healbot first. I think that it's possible, well, it looks like if he is going with the Hellfire here, I'm going to say it looks like it might be possible that getting the additional taunt minion may have
this
been
is,
important.
This is it, I think, isn't it?
Yeah, this is...
Leroy?
No, he's actually short. He's actually short one mana, I believe.
No!
That'll do it.
Oh,
there it is,
there
though,
it
I
is.
Think. Wow.
Leroy
Quick Shot and Hero Power is just enough to have you see him.
Mulligel
is doing a little dance.
Look at VLPS's
face. It's like, this is the one guy you just didn't expect to see. VLPS is just very clearly not amused by Senor Jenkins coming out.
Yeah, VLPS, he's a very calculated player who prides himself on preparation, but there is no preparing yourself for that moment.
Leroy just comes out, time's up, let's do this.
Yep.
It's so exciting to see that card come out. Especially in mid-range Hunter, like, again, BLPS is thinking, okay, I know what mid-range Hunter has. There's no world where he just has a charger with 6 attack, and by the way, there is one.
Yeah, we were talking at the beginning of this match that VLPS was concerned about being surprised by the cards that Mulligel might be playing. He's a player he hasn't seen play, and he does focus very much on preparation, and that is not a card you prepare for out of mid-range Hunter.
Yeah, and Mulligel, of course, coming in as the youngest player, 14 years old. We actually talked to him a little about what it feels like to actually be the youngest player in the America's Championship.
What is it like being the youngest Hearthstone player at 14?
Pô, eu acho super legal porque todo o incentivo que eu tô recebendo é muito grande e começar com essa carreira na cidade que eu sempre gostei é muito legal e pô, só de 14 anos eu tô ganhando uma viagem para conhecer um país novo, completo tudo novo e para jogar e para me divertir é fantástico assim, para mim tá sendo um sonho sendo realizado.
When I was 14, I was only worried about what I was going to eat for lunch every day, and he's flying all the way to the U.S. to play competitive Hearthstone.
I was into those Pogs, man. That Pog life just consumed me. Just slammers. Like, that's what I was doing.
I'm sorry, Rob. You just aged yourself.
I mean,
Beard and no hair not give it away before? I mean, I'm like 35.
Yeah, I've actually been playing competitive games since about I was 14.
I was going to say, we got another guy who played a lot of games as a youngster.
But that was a long time ago.
Yeah. Brian Kibler's been playing competitive games for longer than Mulligel has been alive.
By a lot.
This casting desk is basically no country for old men up here.
Oh, man. All right, well, we're jumping into game number 3 here. It is going to be Mulligel throwing out the Mage, and there's already an interesting card here that we've actually already seen today.
Yeah, Jab obviously debuted that earlier today, the Grand Crusader. I really like this card. When I first heard that this card was in Jab's deck, I asked him why, and he told me, it's because, you're always going to get... Basically, Sylvanas is something you play when you're behind, right, to get the board back. But Sylvanas doesn't do too much as a tempo mage because you want to be ahead. Grand Crusader is a 5/5 body, gives you another card. As a tempo mage, you always want more cards. So I like this reasoning. Mulligel clearly agrees.
Yeah, he's in a little bit of a different situation, though, because he's actually playing Mech Mage. So Mech Mage with Grand Crusader. I suppose Mech Mage is also sort of a tempo-oriented deck, but they sort of run out of stuff really fast, and Grand Crusader might be in there to sort of shore up those weaknesses later on when you empty your hand.
It is interesting to see this chosen specifically over Piloted Sky Golem, which is another six-cost mech that also helps you play this attrition style of game due to its battle cry.
Mulligel, no, don't open the Void Collar. Don't pop it open. I said he has the freezing trap, although it's kind of, you still can't hit the face, so.
Yeah, the emergency.
Not the freezing trap, the emergency cooldown.
I mean, close. I guess it could be close. A freezing
I mean, like, they both make you cold.
Trap, yeah. Right. Well, a lot of times as Mech Mage, if you have to deal with a big creature early on, you lose a lot of steam. If you have to throw your first board, your first, you know, hurrah into the game at a Mal'Ganis, and you lose all that steam, like I said, you don't really have ways to just make your hand bigger or.
For the record,
of longevity.
I briefly thought you said firstborn
that's
instead of firstborn.
I
was like, no, don't throw your firstborn into Mal'Ganis. That's a terrible idea.
That is. That's
sometimes
not
it
good.
Takes that You're sacrifice.
Right. Got to deal with the demon somehow, you know?
Yeah, look, it's got to go if you're going to win this game. So Mulligel's in a situation now where, you know, the Void Collar's just going to sit there. And obviously, on VLPS's turn, he can trade it in to the Tinkertown Technician if he really wants to get the demon out. And Mulligel kind of only really has one play.
He offered up an excellent trade here for VLPS in the Piloted Shredder as well.
Right.
I think he really values pushing that damage instead of dealing with the Void Collar now. Also, if you know that the Void Collar is going to be popped anyway, it's better to allow your opponent to do it because then they don't get immediate value out of the card that they play unless it's Doomguard.
Right.
So let's say he attacked him last turn, Mal'Ganis popped out. That 9 damage is going somewhere the next turn. So. In this situation, Mal'Ganis pops out. Yeah, it's a big threat, but at least it's not going to attack you that turn.
This is one of the reasons why people these days are playing Demon Handlock over the traditional Handlock, because the swing potential off Void Collar can a lot of times just close games right there. Like, this is a game where, and VLPS is actually not even, like, he's not just sacrificing the Void Collar, he's just trading.
Yeah.
Getting resources off the board.
He's trying to play this a little bit slower. He wants to get maximum value from his minion here. He does have the Defender of Argus in play, or in his hand, rather, which can potentially buff that up to trade with an even bigger minion. We did see Mulligel just pick up a pretty important card if this game does go long in Archmage Antonitas. Antonitas turns any spell you play into a fireball, or rather, it gives you a fireball whenever you play a spell. We do see the two spare parts in Mulligel's hand.
Ooh.
That is a Mal'Ganis.
He is not happy to see that.
Yeah.
He's eternal, you know?
Well, he does have that emergency coolant, like you mentioned
and
earlier.
And this is an emergency.
Yes,
this
that
is an emergency.
You might describe that as exactly that.
This is kind of why you save this for in case of eternal Mal'Ganis.
But it's super rough in a situation like this because you know you're going to have to deal with it eventually. And I think he might have sequenced wrong. He didn't get the attack in first in case Mal'Ganis came out. I guess he was seeing what it was going to be, but I think regardless, you're usually going to attack in that situation. In case Mal'Ganis comes out, you still push the damage in the face.
Do you think there's a situation where that coolant's like hanging up on the wall in like a glass container, it's like break in case of Mal'Ganis, and he's like, yep, now's the time.
Yep, exactly.
Stable Ghoul coming out is actually not
It's not good.
Bad, is it?
I mean, it's going to kill his Tinkertown Technician as well. It's going to allow him to just kill that for free, essentially. It does allow Mulligel to use his hero power to kill Mal'Ganis next turn, which is...
So it's
resource.
Like a weird...
Yeah, it's interesting.
Yeah.
Not clear if it's who's this advantageous
not
for
sure
exactly.
Not sure if it's good or not.
Yeah. Well, so VLPS does have the Defender of Argus, so he can choose if that's actually how this is going to play out.
Right. Mal'Ganis getting off the board would be great for Mulligel. Obviously, Grand Crusader next turn is a 5/5. That's a good body. It's going to go ahead and give him a card. And that's important to note. It's not just a Paladin spell. It can be any Paladin card. When I've been playing this lately on ladder, I tend to get Eadric the Pure a lot.
That's a good one.
That's a pretty good card, especially against Handlock. Mulligel, go ahead and just draw Eadric the Pure. I think that's what you're going to want to look for.
Before I read the card, I always thought it was Grand Crusader, 6-mana, 5/5, that gives you Tyrion.
Yeah.
And while this does allow Mulligel to use his hero power to clear Mal'Ganis, it costs a very key turn here. He really wanted to play Grand Crusader there. He wanted to actually develop a minion instead of just playing this Cogmaster, which is extremely low impact.
Yeah, poor Cogmaster. He just got taken out very, very savagely by a dragon.
Well, on the other hand, Mulligel does have some pretty big threats in his hand. Archmage Antonitas is actually a really strong card against hand locks, because a lot of times they're putting themselves in range of fireballs anyway. So if you can get two fireballs out of Archmage Antonidas, you can really get ahead in sort of that resource battle. And Dr. Boom priming the way for the Archmage Antonidas is actually a really good opening for it.
Unfortunately, Dr. Boom, it's just not safe to be a medical professional in this game. Things can sometimes just go south. Very risky trade in Hearthstone.
Yes. He's just Mr. Boom today.
He's just he actually comes out, he's like, I'm not even a doctor. I wouldn't even worry about that. I don't have 7 attack.
Mech Synergy picked up from the Grand Crusader. That's an interesting card.
The Cobalt Guardian.
So every time you play a mech when that's down, it actually gains Divine Shield. So unfortunately, since Divine Shields don't stack, you're going to have to do some trading to possibly really make use of that synergy. But
yeah,
still a solid. It has high attack, which is what I believe Mojel is more interested in right now.
Those two Boombas going to face have really put VLPS in a situation where he can make the most of his Molten Giant here. He now is at 12 health, which means Molten Giant only costs 2 mana. And he does have that Defender of Argus that he just picked up as a draw that he can potentially make a huge wall of taunts this turn.
But now all of a sudden he's dead to double Fireball.
It's
and
true.
Of course, you can't really expect at this stage in the game where we haven't even drawn through half the decks for your opponent to have double Fireball. But VLPS, how does that first or that last match play into it? The quick shot off the top with the Leroy. He's got to be thinking, maybe I need to play it safe. I need to try and, you know, control the board as much as possible in case he has worst case scenario instead of pushing damage. But it looks like he goes with the, aggressive option.
Mech Mage also is a very high damage oriented deck that's based around, you know, bursting the opponent down. Are you worried about Leroy in this one too? Where else could Leroy be?
Yeah, VLPS, we talked about it earlier. He was really nervous about playing Mojo because he really just didn't know what to expect.
VLPS will walk around for the rest of his life, like opening doors, opening cereal boxes. Is Leroy going to come out? It's just not safe anymore. We do see he gets the one fireball off the Archmage. Now, unfortunately, he doesn't really have any more spare parts, so
freezing the Mountain Giant, or the Molten Giant, rather, did make it so that VLPS does not have a lethal attack this turn. If that Mountain Giant, or Molten Giant, screwing them up, they're giants.
They're all
huge, but if it had been able to attack this turn, VLPS would have had lethal damage. But because Molagel did sacrifice his Snowchucker to attack into it, he's staving off lethal, and if he is able to draw another fireball next turn, he might just be able to win the game.
Yeah, so you have to think of your VLPS here. I mean, do you just go the aggressive route and try and put him on a clock? What he can do is like Shadow Flame his Molten Giant, then play Doomguard, not care about what gets discarded, and put Molagel on a one-turn draw.
I think that's what you have to do here. You just have to give him no more chances, because he hasn't drawn otherwise a single fireball organically.
Yeah. Right?
There's still probably 2 in his deck.
Yeah.
Unless for set, there's a weird world where Mojel is just not actually running.
Replace one of the fireballs with a Leroy.
Yeah. that's probably not a good idea. I don't recommend that.
Yeah, I don't advise that.
He opts to keep that Molten Giant.
If there's a fireball here. No.
That's a spider tank. That is definitely not a fireball.
That is not a fireball.
And
so
now he's in a situation where he has to fireball the creatures in order to stay alive.
The Azure Drake will allow him to still deal with that because of the spell damage. And that's not where you want that fireball going. That said, VLPS doesn't have any cards.
He's 1 damage off killing him with the natural Doomguard. And at this point, he's just going to go for it. He knows that he can't be dead to double fireball with a Lotheb on the board, so he's got to be feeling pretty confident. He's thinking, what could Mojel possibly have that would allow him to at least prolong this game?
The answer is, obviously, as we know, kind of nothing. Goblin Blast Mage. If Goblin Blast Mage hits 3 times on the Sun Fury, oof.
No. And that, I believe, is going to lock things up in this game.
Yeah.
The Lotheb, of course, increasing the cost of all of Mojel's spells by 5 for this turn, so he was not able to cast that Frostbolt in his hand as well as other spells. And there's the Doomguard, and that's going to be it.
Yeah, look at VLPS, hyper-focused after that game, too. He does not want to put himself in another situation where Leroy is going to be his downfall, and he's going to take a 2-1 lead in the series. He's out match point.
Yeah, for VLPS, feels good to get out of that one without, like you said, seeing Leroy, seeing all those fireballs come out, and you know he's 1 game away now from advancing to his next match.
Yeah, but he looked a little stressed out after that second game when he did get bursted down by that Leroy.
Yeah.
Maybe more than a little. Maybe that's putting it lightly. So I have to imagine getting that win with his hand luck deck here is going to do a lot to increase his confidence going to this next game.
Yeah. VLPS is a player who, we talked about him earlier, he A lot of players, when they came here, they socialized quite a bit. They got to know each other a lot. VLPS has been doing that as well, but he's actually spent a lot of time absorbing information from the back, like trying to, determine what his opponent's decks are and what they're playing, put them in vulnerable situations where he can get all the information out of them as he possibly can. And he looks ready.
Vulnerable situation? I don't even know what that's about.
Oh, well.
So you see, Molajel's going to go ahead and bring out the Paladin deck. Spectral Knight. That is an interesting card.
So that's actually a card that we were talking a little bit about the other day in terms of interesting cards that the Brazilian players used in their qualifier stages that are not really seen in the normal North American metagame. And that was one of them. And there were some players who were speculating that Molajel may have made some of his card choices based on not really having all the cards in his account. He didn't only started playing recently. But it looks like he stuck with his Spectral Knight for this tournament.
So Spectral Knight, the advantage is super difficult to actually get off the board, which means you can start putting more and more damage into your opponent's face if they don't have a weapon, they don't have something like a Blade Flurry, or just something that clears high amounts of or high health opponent or minions off the board. It can be really difficult to deal with, and that might be something that factors in, given that Molajel's Paladin deck, as we've seen, has that Jeskar True Heart. Looks to really overwhelm the opponent by developing just a very, very intimidating board.
Yeah, the biggest advantage, or deck that you have an advantage over by running Spectral Knight, is actually Warrior, because a lot of their removal is targeted, especially Control Warrior, where they use Executes and Shield Slams. If you remember back to the days like a year ago or so when Control Warrior was really popular, Druids, mid-range Druids would run Spectral Knight, and that was one of the reasons why classically mid-range Druid was considered to be really favorable against Control Warriors because of that card.
It's also Deathbite, obviously, is capable of dealing with stuff like Sludge Belcher because it can deal up to 5 points of damage once the weapon breaks. Having 6 health and not being targetable by spell is very difficult for the Warrior to deal with. There was actually a time where I was late at night and I had lost a bunch of games and I was in a bad place and I was like, Fen Creeper? You have 6 health. You're probably strictly better than Sludge Belcher against Control Warriors. Obviously, I changed my mind. But, 6 health, just great stat line against a Warrior.
Yeah, and Molajel with a pretty good opening here. He would have loved to have played that Muster for Battle on turn 3, but the Acolyte of Pain from VLPS made that a dangerous proposition. So the coin and True Silver Champion takes that out. Now VLPS in a situation where he's forced to use his removal effects on these individual Silverhand recruits, which is not the most efficient exchange.
This matchup for a long time was very much Paladin dominated, because Paladin just keeps putting out minions and Warrior keeps trying to find ways to effectively remove them, but they kind of run out of resources. Paladin also doesn't have like super good card draw either. It's just the hero power absolutely makes the matchup for them.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's hard for them. Warriors usually have spot removal for large creatures, like Shield Slams and Executes. When they have to use those on medium-sized creatures, it paves the way for the big ones later on, like Dr. Boom, like Tyrion. If you use all your removals on...
Oh,
whoa,
wow.
That's a big deal.
Now, so this is interesting now. Do you save it for something like a second True Silver, which is just statistically more menacing,
that's
or do
three
you draw
cards,
the
Rob.
Cards? TJ, I know, but...
And it looks like VLPS chooses to go with the Emperor Thoris in this turn. This does give him a much more potent curve over the next several turns. He's able to play multiple minions, even Dr. Boom, and a weapon next turn.
And you can see on your screen there from Mojel the Jeskar True Heart. Of course, we talked about it a little bit earlier. Battlecry, replace your starting hero power with a better one. And the better one, in the case of Paladins, means you summon 2 Silverhand recruits instead of 1 for the rest of the game after you use Jeskar True Heart to replace your hero power. So when you're playing grindy games like this, you mentioned earlier how using that hero power a lot makes it tough for Warriors to completely clear the board and you can peck away at them. Jeskar True Heart makes that even tougher.
Oh, yeah.
So really great card.
I feel like Molajel might actually be trying to bait out a Brawl right here. It's not going to come out though. And opted to not play that Jeskar True Heart last turn. And again, by developing big boards against Control Warrior, you want to see those brawls come out so then you can start playing like your other bigger minions and not necessarily be afraid of just a total board wipe.
Mm-hmm. It's very interesting to see that Molajel here, he is playing the mid-range style of Paladin deck rather than Secret Paladin, which is one of the more popular versions. We also saw Trump playing mid-range as well. And VLPS also playing a much less previously this tournament popular version of Warrior with Control. We only saw, I believe, 2 players with Patron Warrior in this event. We've actually seen more Control Warriors, I believe, if my memory serves correctly.
We saw a lot of Control Warriors, and VLPS is a player that plays almost primarily Control Warrior. He doesn't like Patron. He says, he claims, and I will agree with him because I've seen him play a lot of it, that he has over 10,000 games with Control Warrior Alone.
Over 10,000 games?
Yes.
I don't even think I can count that high.
It would take me a long time. Yeah.
I gave up around like 8. It's too big of a number.
Not 8,000, just 8.
No, just literally just 8. Something I want to point out, this is very interesting because of Emperor Thorsan. The LPS has the ability on his next turn, at any point going forward, to just Sylvanas and Brawl.
Yep.
And that's usually something you have to set up, but he can actually just do that at any time going forward, which against Paladin, because of Tyrion,
right,
is actually super important.
Yeah. Well, sometimes you can just end up with a 1-1 and they get their weapon anyway, but best case scenario is you either steal the Tyrion or your Sylvanas lives. So right. Both are sort of, you know, best case.
And Molajal welcomes BLPS to the Grand Tour. Goes ahead and he's going to celebrate by, you know, bringing in some dudes.
And we were talking a bit earlier about the situations in which Justicar Trueheart is powerful, and this is one of them that it's the most powerful. Because these are both decks that are looking to play a very long game, and the more times you use your hero power, the more value you're getting out of Justicar Trueheart. And in this game, which is very likely to go until both players have completely exhausted all of their resources, Justicar Trueheart being able to be used every turn to generate an additional minion is huge, huge value in the long game.
I would actually argue this is probably the most important card in Molajal's deck in this matchup.
Absolutely. It is incredibly powerful here.
There's a world where, you know, he was considering that Shield Maiden, but then you hit. Do you Shield Slam? Yeah, the Justicar Trueheart. That feels bad. I'm just going to go out there. That does not feel good.
Oh, absolutely.
That's a lot of overkill. He really does not like that Justicar Trueheart.
He's like, I didn't want to go to the Grand Tournament.
Yeah. That's one of the trade-offs with Justicar Trueheart, is it is not the best body. It only has 3 health, so you sort of have to find a good time to play it. And
it's an okay.
He did.
It's an okay body.
I mean, that was a perfect time. Not only does this give Molajal this, you know, continuing powerful ability moving forward, but requiring BLPS, or at least incentivizing him to use one of his most efficient and powerful removal spells to get rid of it, is extremely important as the game will progress.
Yeah. Deathbite actually a very, very good draw right there.
Oh, yes.
As we see a board full of 1-1s just waiting to be whirlwinded.
Yeah.
He's going to go ahead and pop the top on that Shredder. See what we get there.
BLPS BLPS's mechanical play is actually really strong. His placements on his pile of Shredders, even his sequencing with attacking. Say like an Annoyotron had come out of that pile of Shredder. He attacked into the 1-1 first to make sure that he killed it, just in case a taunt would come out. He really, like, all the little things really add up in close games of Hearthstone, especially at this high of a competitive level. And VLPS has really been on top of those small things that give you slight edges over time.
Speaking of little things, we see Dr. Boom is now down to 4 health. He is a manslayer. He has gotten rid of 3 1-1s. Like, if this was old StarCraft back in the day where you just highlighted over your units and it told you how many things it had killed, like, Dr. Boom is basically a hero unit at this point.
Yeah. He had his medical license revoked earlier in the day by Big Game Hunter, but now he's becoming a pro wrestler.
I'd just like to point out, he got rid of a lot of stuff there. Dr. Boom, in that scenario, actually did not just straight up get removed.
This is a pretty good turn for VLPS. He's able to play Ysera, which is an extremely strong card, as we were saying, in attrition-based matchups, because it does effectively draw you a card every turn. But Molajal does have the answer here with the Equality in his hand, which I have to imagine we're going to see.
And VLPS ends up getting the Dream also, which in this situation might not be the best of cards.
Well, no, okay, maybe it is here because Tyrion comes down. Now, Dr. Boom would come down. That's not what you want, but it's going to allow him to spend 0 mana.
But he has a pretty good chance here
Brawling. Yeah.
And the fact that VLPS has Harrison Jones in his hand as well, even if, say, the Mistress of Pain wins the Brawl, and then Molajal gets the Ashbringer, he's going to be able to use Harrison Jones to destroy the Ashbringer as well.
And draw cards, which is a huge deal at this stage in the game, because
Molajal's starting to run out of resources.
Yeah, so is VLPS. They both are. And at the end of the game like this, when both players are starting to run out of resources, Harrison Jones, or any card draw for that matter, gives you a huge edge moving forward.
This is kind of a pivotal turn here, because VLPS has two different lines of play. You can Sylvanas and Brawl, or you just Brawl and then look to Harrison.
Yeah.
And we see here he's opted for this. He's going
to
Dream.
Okay, I like this. He's using the Dream to bounce the Mistress of Pain, so he's guaranteed to either get Tyrion or kill Tyrion and keep Sylvanas.
Wow, this is going to be a big deal. I think he wants to steal it, but the Sylvanas lives through the Brawl.
Just like in lore, Sylvanas beats Tyrion Fordring.
Yeah.
And
it's not often that we find ourselves in situations like that.
Allow Molajal Allow Mol'Jell to use Ashbringer, the first charge, to kill Sylvanas while not giving VLPS any resource.
Right.
Then he can play Dr. Boom here, and VLPS really wants to play that Harrison Jones to get rid of Ashbringer right away.
Yeah. He is going to be able to Harrison Jones down, but that's only two cards, and in the meantime, Mol'Jell has actually built up a really intimidating board with Dr. Boom.
Every single time with that hero power, just creating those 1-1s, it just makes things that much more difficult for VLPS. Now, he does pick up the second Deathbite there. And that's very important because it will allow him to get kind of another soft clear on these 1-1s over the course of two turns. But yeah, we see he's just going for it.
It also potentially sets up a lethal attack if he does draw Grommash. He puts Mol'Jell down to 14 health. That, along with the damage from Deathbite, if it is able to enrage Grom, will be exactly lethal. Yeah. But Mol'Jell does pick up Lay on Hands.
Yeah, is he going to feel like he needs to play it safe here and use the Lay on Hands? He's hovering over it, and he might think, well, he went phased. That's a little bit odd. If he does have Grom, I'm dead. So he plays it safe, goes for the Lay on Hands. He still has a pretty commanding lead over the board. And he picks up, wow, double Consecrate and a Knife Juggler.
Now, do you maybe consider clearing the Armorsmith with the Dr. Boom? Is that just too much damage you can't leave on the table?
I don't think you're too worried about how much armor the Armorsmith's going to gain because, like Kibler mentioned earlier, you're okay with playing the long game because you played the Justicar Trueheart. You're getting so much value out of the 1-1s. Eventually, you're going to be able to push through anyway. He decides that, you know what, it could be a little rough, so he does it anyway.
Yeah, after he kind of sends out, sees where that first bomb goes. The first bomb doesn't kill the Armorsmith. He's like, all right, time to send in the big guns. And even if VLPS doesn't draw Grom here, that's a pretty good turn 10 he's looking at in hand with the old double belcher, but Mol'Jell just has so many cards after that lay on hand.
Hey, Mol'Jell is
way ahead. Why, Dr. Boom? You were so young.
Mr. Boom, I told you you weren't allowed to practice.
He's been kicked off the premises like 8 times today, and he just keeps coming back, and Big Game Hunter's like, hey, we had a talk.
I mean, we see Mol'Jell with a second copy of Knife Juggler in his hand, as well as that hero power is making 2 Silverhand recruits a turn.
I'm following you, Brian. He's got to do it.
You see what he's got to do?
And muster for battle.
There's no Armorsmith. You have to do it.
he does decide to just go ahead and equip the True Silver Champion first.
All right. He doesn't play. Yeah, so he doesn't play. He still has the opportunity to do something crazy in future turns, but yeah, he's playing a little bit safer right now, which can't really fault him, obviously. Trying to get the safe play. Consecration is going to be huge for him.
Yeah, lines up really nicely in the Consecration, and VLPS is just out of stuff. He's got a Sludge Belcher in his hand. He's already been through Harrison Jones, so not really any means of card draw. And he's not anywhere near to closing out the game with like a Grom top deck. Shield Maiden is going to be able to fight for the board quite well, but
the 6 mana cost means he can't play it with Sludge Belcher. Yeah. He can't try to build his own really pressuring board.
Yeah. With his window to end the game with Grom now essentially gone because of the Death Bite going away this turn, it's a very difficult spot for VLPS to come back into this game because he is playing against that hero power that which is already by itself just making individual Silverhand recruits very powerful. But now it's doubled by Justicar Trueheart and is going to be
Oh man, this is one of the ultimate turn 10 combos that you could go for. He actually opts just to go for the hero power now and save the quartermaster from when he knows that his 1-1s are going to survive.
But also looks like he just wants to get the juggle down as well, potentially be able to clear off.
He's like, Knife Juggler, come on!
They all went face, and now he can't clear it with his True Silver Champion, so...
I think he may just True Silver the face this turn because he wants to cast Muster next turn.
Yeah.
He does also put himself up to 19.
Which puts him out of range of Grom's cool Taskmaster, plus the Shield Maiden hit, so...
Right.
Shield Slam, I think, a pretty important draw to deal with that 5-5.
Yeah, but he can't play anything else. He just armors up and Shield Slams if he wants to remove
it. It's also potentially another enabler for Grommash later in the game as well.
Right. I think you mentioned the cruel Taskmaster. I'm not sure how many VLPS is running, but we have seen one already.
I believe we actually saw both of them come down early on to kill Silverhand recruits.
Yep. Okay. So
That's not that great of a trade when you're trading a cruel Taskmaster for...
No, but sometimes you have to do it, right?
Like,
sometimes
you
just have to.
It is time.
No, he won't have enough.
Yeah, he can trade in those initially.
Okay. As long as he trades in. Otherwise, he wouldn't have had enough space. Yeah, there's too many dudes on this battle.
We're seeing one of the very small issues with playing Justicar Trueheart. Sometimes you have many dudes.
Here's your drawback. Got to trade in a dude, and then just here comes Quartermaster. Oh, he's deciding.
He might as well just trade in both.
This is just like having too many friends and you don't have enough space to invite them all to a birthday party and you're like, oh, some of them have to get sacrificed so the other ones can come to my birthday.
Oh yeah, I have that problem all the time.
Oh yeah, sacrificing friends.
And now, VLPS is just getting buried here. We have five silver handed fruits.
He can execute one of them. Yeah.
not even yet. They haven't taken damage.
I really like the, I just want to point out the art for the upgraded hero power too. It's just like the dude like back to back like, yeah, we're dudes.
What's up?
We're hanging out. We're friends.
I got his back. You got my back?
Yeah.
All right. We're
all
good.
Right.
We're good.
Bad boys for life. Let's do it. No, he does. He keeps the owl, which I think is a pretty heads up play.
Yeah.
You don't need to use it right now. You don't have enough
so
to threaten
so far
lethal.
Ahead.
Yep.
I mean, if VLPS has another copy of Brawl, Molajil can just keep using his hero power and continue. Well, but can't anymore because he has too many guys.
Even if he has a copy of Brawl, again, like, look at Molajil's hand.
I'm just saying that Molajil can, because he has this hero power, that can enable him to continue.
Double execute.
Wow.
Okay, there's two damage minions on the board. I see two executes. This play lines
we
up.
Got targets.
We got targets.
We got targets, guys.
I mean, VLPS has to realize
this is totally
that Molajil can just hold on to this board. He can't even play anything. He can't even trade his minions in anything. Yeah. So VLPS might realize that, you know, executes could be his only play.
Well, you know, if he executed a 2-2, maybe a 5-6 or a 4-6 with Untargetable comes down.
But I believe Molajil is doing 18 damage a turn here, so you can't hold on to that for very long.
Yeah, this is going to be his last turn. See if he does, like, maybe a...
Acolyte of Pain, that's not going to do it.
That's going to do it. Molajil looks like he's going to tie up the series.
Wow.
It is now 2-2. Molajil has kept VLPS basically at arm's length as far as closing out the series, and we're going to go to a decisive game five. So impressed with Molajil on this
one. Yeah, and Molajil, we talked about it earlier, he's 14 years old, and he's sort of become the pride of Brazil.
How important is it to you to represent Brazil in this tournament?
Eu acho que eu tô com um peso muito grande nas costas porque a comunidade brasileira ainda não é tão evoluída em todos os esportes. Ela é muito grande, ela já tá virando muito gigantesca, você pode ver pelo número de equipes profissionais que estão surgindo. Ela é forte, mas não é tão forte quanto a americana, e principalmente no Hearthstone, que é um jogo novo e que tá sendo novo no cenário brasileiro. Então, ganhar uma vaga na BlizzCon, tanto a minha quanto do Coreia, vai pesar demais para os norte-americanos, dar mais oportunidades para os sul-americanos, não só como o Brasil, mas como toda a América Latina, que nós temos excelentes players no Chile, na Argentina e em outros países.
It's really cool to see the camaraderie between the two Brazilian players, and we're going to go into game number five, but we have another country battle on our hands. This is Molajil representing Brazil, and of course VLPS representing the U.S. So get on social media, let us know who you think is going to take it. You can hashtag BrazilWin or BRWin, or you can hashtag USAWin. Let us know your predictions, who you're rooting for. Of course, Molajil being the underdog coming in as the Brazilian and the 14-year-old and VLPS, that calculated ladder hero. So get on social media, join in on those conversations.
Yeah, I think VLPS, he hasn't necessarily won too many things that people are aware of, like, he's kind of a quiet favorite for this. A lot of people I've talked to have said that they really expect him to be the America's champion at the end of this tournament. And, you know, Molajil, again, tying up the series, huge kudos to him, and he may very well take it.
This last game could be really tough, though. We saw that Molajil is playing Mech Mage. And Mech Mage is a deck that, against Control Warrior, has a very, very strong matchup. In particular, thanks to the power of Snow Chugger. The fact that you can freeze your opponent's early weapon hits and keep them from being able to use their weapons effectively as removal really puts them in an awkward spot as you get to the mid and late game.
Yeah, it's very true. And a lot of times you can just snowball the game from there because, like you said, the weapons are so crucial in that early stage for Control Warrior to get them to that mid-game where they can play big cards like Shield Maiden and stuff like that.
We do see VLPS with one of the most important cards from the Warrior side in his opening hand. Keeps that Brawl.
Oh, we see Snow Chugger, though, drawn by Molajil. This could, depending upon how Molajil chooses to sequence this, this could be very bad for VLPS.
Yeah. VLPS does have the Fiery War Axe in his opening hand, so he can start, if he chooses, to chip away at this offense. Armorsmith also matches up pretty well against that that Clockwork Gnome in play. And then Brawl is a way that he can actually come back in a game where Molajil is able to establish a very large board presence, even if he is frozen by a Snow Chugger, to really clear the board.
I think if you're Molajil too, you kind of hope that in your next few draws, you come into Tinkertown Technician, come into Goblin Blast Mage, kind of those big authoritative cards that make, we see him get the Tinkertown Technician there, that, you know, you kind of have to have the Deathbite as a warrior or else you just get buried.
This is a very conservative line of play for Molagel. He does take out the Armorsmith rather than attacking the phase. He doesn't want, I suppose, to let VLPS potentially abuse that Armorsmith in some capacity.
Now, VLPS can actually full clear the board here.
Yeah.
Chooses not to. Chooses to just get rid of the Snow Chugger. And, you know, this is actually completely fine because it means that he won't have a mech down for Tinkertown Technician. He will be able to buff the Cogmaster back up, so.
And also, it fits his curve, which isn't necessarily as important when you're sort of the control deck playing against a more aggressive deck, but sometimes it can really matter because he can fit in Fiery War Axe with other cards later on, where if he wanted to armor up Shield Slam later in the game, that might take up too much of his turn in, to be able to play other cards.
Yeah, expect to see this Clockwork Gnome being taken up by the Fiery War Axe and then armor up. And for VLPS, the name of the game is just Outlast. Your late game is obviously way better than Molagel, so. You just kind of have to keep him from killing you. And also, VLPS heading into turn 5 this next turn at 30 health.
Yeah, I mean, any
it's above average.
Anytime that VLPS can have a productive and interactive turn and uses hero power helps him get to that stage of the game where he can play his really powerful cards, like the ones we see in his hand. I mean, if Molagel is sort of rushing him down and then he manages to get to the point where he can play Alexstrasza, it just undoes so much of the damage that that the Mech Mage Vic does early.
We were talking about interesting cards that Molagel's brought in. We see both Flamestrike and Arcane Intellect in Mech Mage, and those are not staples of the deck because obviously with Mech Mage, what you want to be doing is having such a high density of mechs that you just continue to flood the board, you abuse that synergy just to put a whole bunch of damage on, look at freezing effects to lock the warrior out of weapons, but Flamestrike, got to wonder what he's targeting with that. Maybe Paladin is very popular.
Yeah.
So kind of interesting to see that stuff.
The Arcane Intellect as well. Typically, you see cards like perhaps Azure Drake that are used to sort of pick up additional resources in the Mech Mage deck because they're allowing you to continue to advance your board presence as well. We saw that Arcane Intellect effectively required Molagel to give up his entire turn to play it. And now, VLPS looks like he might be turning the corner.
Yeah, and we talked about it earlier. One of the weaknesses of Mech Mage can be against slower decks that do have good starts. They can run out of resources. Arcane Intellect can help with that, but like Kibler said, you're just giving up your entire turn, and especially when Control Warriors have cards like Brawl, it's really hard for you to sort of hold on to resources long enough to push through all the removal and all the big threats that they're going to put out. So, not sure how much it's going to help him. We'll have to see. He did get a little bit of a bigger hand and does have a semblance of board control, but it's going to be tough.
Like, Molagel's finally starting to put together that intimidating board as of the last turn, but it's a little bit late now. The warrior has the mana. It has the ability to put out big threats. The Deathbite came online, and unfortunately for Molagel, it's going to be a very uphill battle if he wants to do this. Goblin Blast Mage now. Very interesting because of the Boombots.
I mean, Molagel can clear the board here with that Flamestrike. He can attack into Dr. Boom, play Flamestrike, but that leaves him with absolutely nothing, passing the turn to a Control Warrior who's at 27 going into having 8 mana. It's just a terrible position to be in.
Yeah, resetting against a Control Warrior is sort of playing right into what they
That's
want
what they
you
want,
to do.
Yeah.
Also, if Molagel plays his Blast Mage before the Spider Tank does something, yeah, he decides to go ahead and attack with it because those Boombots could have been extremely problematic. So we'll see here.
Okay.
Yep.
Ooh, Boombot takes down the Spider Tank.
Not the worst outcome in the world for Molagel. It does take out his Spider Tank, but like you said, he did get that attack in with it. So.
And he's got 5 cards in hand, but it's very deceptive. 3 of those are spare parts.
Right.
One of them is Flamestrike, and as a Mech Mage, you have to be pushing your agenda, right? You're not looking to win the game with a late game combo. Mm-hmm.
Though, interestingly, his Flamestrike is going to be good here. He's going to be able to Flamestrike, clear this board, kill Dr. Doom, and still have his 5 attack minion in play.
That could have gotten a lot worse for Molagel. This is actually fairly clean. He does have to give up the Annoitron, but keeps a 5-4 on the board, and you know, 5 damage a turn is a good way to kill your opponent.
Those couple of slower tech cards making it.
Speaking of killing your opponent,
wow.
An aggressive Alexstrasza is not what you tend to see when you're playing against aggressive decks, but VLPS feels comfortable that he is sufficiently far ahead that he just goes ahead and sets Molagel to 15 life.
Now, Brian, as a resident Dragon Master on this deck, what wins in a match between a Goblin, Blast Mage, and a Dragon?
You could have said anything in a Dragon, and you know what I would have chosen.
I mean, that's fair. That's absolutely fair. But yeah, this is kind of a situation now where Molagel is suddenly on the back foot, and if he has to use that Frostbolt to slow down the Alexstrasza, or even just get rid of it, that's not what he wants to do.
No, not at all.
See here, VLPS, you know, has the Sylvanas, has the weapon, could be looking to draw Grom in the next few turns to end this, and And Molajel's not going to be doing any healing. That's not really what Mechmage does, unless, you know, we maybe see an antique healbot, technically a mech.
Yeah, at this stage, as the Mechmage, you're usually looking at a turn where you're trying to draw into burn spells to end the game. But VLPS had such a great defensive early game hand that he hasn't really taken as much damage as you'd usually expect going into this matchup.
Well, and it's also worth noting that Molajel's decision-making early on was, you know, he spent a turn using Arcane Intellect, which, you know, you get cards, set him back in terms of tempo, and tempo is very important to this matchup for the mage.
Yeah, it's very true, and that's sort of his deck choices as well, playing slower cards, playing cards that he knows are going to sort of slow down that tempo in the mid-game for him is a choice that he made, so we'll have to see if it's going to pay off for him. Right now, he's in a tough spot.
And again, we see Emperor Thorsen come down for VLPS, which does set him up to potentially play Brawl and Sylvanas in the same turn. So even if Molajel is able to establish a significant board presence, VLPS has the tools to just swing it directly back in his favor.
And again, we see Molajel trading. And, I mean, VLPS is still at 21 health. He's at a very healthy HP total. You know, Molajel could have looked at putting 9 damage into VLPS based on what was on the board at the time. But he has to trade, try to stay alive, and this does play around Brawl pretty decently.
Molajel left with nothing but spare parts here. If he picks up a Archmage Antonitis, perhaps that could be enough for him to remain competitive in this game, but he is falling behind drastically.
Yeah, VLPS has to have been keeping track of these spare parts and know that his hand is empty. And look at that, he actually calls him out and says, you know what, I'm going to go aggressive and force you to make the trades. And that's a fireball, but he's still quite a bit of ways off of lethal damage, so he can't really use that to much effect. Fireballing the Sylvanas just gives VLPS one of his own creatures, so a little bit rough.
Right, and we see you know, VLPS is currently representing 9 damage. Molajel only has 11, so Molajel has to figure out, yeah, it looks like he's again, just I mean, at least he got mech synergy. He got mech synergy. If there was a mech in Molajel's hand, it would be very cheap.
He's hoping for the scavenging hyena to be stolen here, but the mech warper.
Scavenging hyena is a loyal beast. Chooses to stay with Molajel. Molajel again, just kind of grasping his draws here. You know, what does he even do to try to get back into this? I think that last turn, he had to get Archmage Antonitis to really kind of have any hope. And, you know, he will have another turn, it looks like, unless Grom comes off the top. Because I don't think there's anything else in VLPS's deck that actually represents that much damage.
Wow, he threw the fireball into the mech warper. He realized that at this point, he's probably not going to burn VLPS out. He needs to just try and make his creatures go as far as they possibly can.
And this is 100% Molajel playing around Grom.
Yep. I think if you're in this position as Molajel, I'm not sure you can afford to do this. I think you may be in the position where you have to just hope your opponent doesn't have it. Because even now, if he drew Archmage Antonitis, he's only able to actually generate a single fireball before his opponent can potentially kill the Archmage. And in particular with Time Rewinder as his only remaining spare part, he can't even do that if his opponent is able to remove minions from his board.
For VLPS now, he can just swing with the Deathbite. He can re-equip the Fiery War Axe on the next turn. He doesn't even need to do it this turn, really.
Just in case there's something like a Harrison Jones.
Something. Yeah, it's just, you know, obviously it seems far-fetched, but you obviously want to play around your outs. And, yeah, we actually see VLPS decide to just clear the board, realize that he's got 6 damage in hand. And again, put the onus on Molajel. Again, lethal next turn for VLPS, and this plays around any funny business coming out for Molajel.
Yeah, really grinding him out. And he needs some way to deal with the Harrison this turn. Is he going to find it?
Spider tank is not going to be
it. And with that, Molajel's probably going to realize that his
you see a sigh of relief from VLPS as he realizes he has the win right now.
Yeah, well played comes out with the Fire War Axe equipped. VLPS.
Yeah, VLPS
is going to take game 5.
Takes game 5, wins the series. Molajel very, very cool about it. Lets him do it. Yeah. Doesn't just concede. Molajel, you know, there's no hard feelings on his face. He understands he just played one of North America's best players, most consistent players, and yeah.
So yeah, they hug it out. Hug there.
They just hug that right out. And congrats to VLPS on taking that series. He is going to head to the upper bracket now for, you know, his date with, I believe, it is Anias.
Yeah. So VLPS, I mean, he's just one more match win away from making it to those coveted semifinal matchups. So definitely winning that first match is a big step for all these players.
Yeah, the players who lost just now, they're still in it. They do move to the loser's bracket, which we'll see tomorrow. Mm-hmm. They need to win 2 more matches in order to actually make it to the semifinals, while the winner of the upper bracket match has one more shot to go directly there.
And I just want to point out, Nias versus DLPS is going to be crazy.
Yeah.
I am fully expecting that to be an amazing series.
Yeah, well, we have our winners' matches coming up next. Those are going to be the next two games. We want to give take an opportunity to give a big shout-out to our sponsors, of course, the Amazon App Store, as well as Totino's. But we are going to go to a quick break before we jump into our first winners' match. But before we do that, we'll leave you with some highlights from that last match.